1-2, 1-2, 1-2, 1-2, 1-2, peace signs, can you put them up?
I love you, Kirk.
In your spiritual life now, with this incredible body of work that you've put out, who is Snoop's coach? Who is Snoop's advisor? Who is Snoop's spiritual leader or pastor or whatever? Who because it is important, like you see with the kids, mm-hmm. who is that to Snoop?
Wow. I have a lot of great influences in my life that I look up to, that I call on, that I can go to for advice, for ministry, for information, and just to check me. Because sometimes we need to be checked.
I'm first in need of though.
My Uncle Charlie Wilson, always on the battlefield for me. The Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, always on the battlefield for me. And these are brothers that I can go to that really tell me what I need to hear even when I don't want to hear.
When you talk about these influences, and of course sure that because you are a celebrity, it's probably been hard for you to have somebody who is not always excited about being connected to you and somebody that is wanting to make more deposits than they are withdrawals.
Right.
And I dig that.
Right.
And I know that that has been the challenge that we've seen a lot in the contemporary church. Because mm-hmm. in the church, a lot of times we embrace celebrities, but then overlook the common person.
Right.
And the common person needs the same type of medicine that the celebrity needs. Mm-hmm. And we've made celebrities out of people that are just overnight celebrities that don't even deserve the title, don't even need what the title is. First of all, that title should be checked at the door.
Right.
When you come to the house of God.
Ain't no celebrity when you walk into God's house.
There should be only one.
Hello, he's the celebrity.
And we all are his groupies.
Now, hello, believe that.
Holler at your boy, right?
I wish he was here right now, I'd take a selfie with him. Watch out, y'all. Me and God got this understanding. I need to get that first.
That is hilarious.
And Jesus, you get in there with us too.
And if you get one before me, I'm jealous. I'm telling you. The brothers and sisters in the community didn't see the church always do the right thing in the community. You've seen it. I've seen it. And this is not a church bashing moment because the church has done a lot of good
They've
as well.
They've done great work.
They've done a lot of good as well. When you were coming up with brothers who was fighting just for their life, who was on the corner, on the block, just trying to pay bills, and when the game hit real big, because we all know when the drug game hit big, mm-hmm. it hit big in Texas.
Everywhere.
It
was an epidemic.
It was in the 80s and 90s, we saw it, and we saw the brothers going down day and night. And a lot of the brothers lost respect and hope in the church. What can people like me do better? Because, see, you're somebody that's saying, I'm coming in. I'm somebody who's saying I've been there the whole time, and I know the mistakes that we made. What can the church do better?
The first thing the church can do better is be so non-judgmental. Open your arms. Open them up for the worst. For the worst sinner.
I agree.
You get what I'm saying?
I agree.
I don't give
for
a
the worst.
Care what he done. If
for
he,
the worst.
Let him in.
For
and
the
if
worst.
You when you lose that, that's half the battle.
Yeah.
Because now you're doing God's work.
Yeah.
You're not judging somebody. You're allowing them to come get their spirit right and to repent and to testify and to try to find their way and maybe come down to the altar and get born again.
Yeah.
But don't close them out before they come in because of what they've been doing out there. They can go back out there and get that.
And that's very sad that we would even close them out. If it's any hospital that turns away sick people needs to be shut down.
Mm.
And I agree with that. And not only that, we can't send people to hospitals that have sick doctors as well.
Hello, that's the key.
My question to you is, how do we still lovingly encourage people to not be sick patients the rest of their life? The same way we do in the hood. Like, you don't want to be a second and third generation, living in the projects type of, you should want to be better, right? You should want to grow and be better. If that's the same way physically, how do we, Snoop, still encourage people spiritually that you should want to grow and the old man change into a better new man?
It's the language. We have to learn to speak the language of the people. If there's no dialogue, if I don't speak the language that you speak, you speak in Spanish, I'm speaking Turkish, we ain't finna get nowhere. But if we speak in the same gospel and the same understanding, well, you're not chastising me.
That's good.
You're correcting me.
That's good.
You helping me.
In love.
Exactly. You know, the way me and you talking right now, you're not on here bashing me about what I did. I ain't talking about what you did. We're talking about how can we get better?
Right.
What can we do to make this become a situation where more brothers like me and you have sit-downs away from the camera?
Which I think would be dope.
Really real. You understand what I'm saying?
Wouldn't that be dope, though?
Yeah, where it's real.
If there was a place where people felt safe.
To really just sit down and have a nice conversation when we could chop it up. Shout out to Deion Sanders for making this connection. Let me say that.
Tell him the story, man. Tell him the story.
Deion Sanders is a friend of Kirk's, a friend of mine, and he knew our spirits were supposed to be together. So Deion did the old three-way trick and called us on the three-way and put us on the phone and let our spirits become one. And that's what he was supposed to do. That's brotherhood. That's fellowship. That's what the church is built on. I know that for a fact.
Yeah.
And that's what he was doing. He was bringing those spirits together, bringing my spirit from the outside to the inside. And you was lacing me with the game, giving me information and getting me right. So when I step back into the house of the Lord, I'm prepared.
And I think that if you can help me encourage people to remember that even somebody like Snoop, but you know, because I know that with this album, you gotta, you know, some of the church folk, how can he mm-hmm, be this mm-hmm, and woo. And it breaks my heart when the church community loses all the essence of love in their language. That even when my son comes home with bad grades, to beat him down, that's not being burned. Here's a great illustration that I think you dig and take this wherever you go. The Queen of England was shopping with her daughter one day, and they were in a store. And the Queen of England's daughter, and you know, she's the clear Queen of England, they shut the store down.
Shut down,
Secret Service all over the place, earpieces, everybody, you know, posted. And the daughter, the Queen's daughter was jumping on the mannequins, you know, running around going crazy. And the Queen would say, no, stop, get off the mannequin before you break it. And she stopped for a minute. But then after a minute, she jumped on something else, so, you know, on like the bed, jumped on the bed, and she broke something. And the Queen was like, baby girl, you got to get off the stuff. Hey, get your butt down. Get your raw butt down, right? And so she stopped for a minute. And then after a while, she didn't break something else. And the Queen of England said, you know, I'm going to try another approach. And the Queen of England said to her daughter, come in. Don't you know that someday when I die, all of this is going to be yours? You're going to be the ruler of all of this. You are a queen in the making. And to tear down this stuff, you're tearing down what is going to be yours to rule over. This belongs to you. Yeah. And what she did, instead of tearing her down for what she did, she built her up and reminded her of our true identity and her true future, who you are. And I think that Christians don't realize that when Jesus breathes on us, we're not fully who we're going to be.
Not yet. He ain't done working on us yet.
He ain't done working. And so we got to learn how to come along people and remember that God don't wear a watch.
Nah.
And neither should we.
Mm-mm.
That we shouldn't be doing like this. Well, you know what? Snoop's still doing this. Okay, he dropped that album, and I'm looking. Mm-mm. No, girl, look, girl, he ain't doing that no better. Girl, it's like you need to get rid of the watch.
Right.
And let God do the process.
Hello.
You didn't need the money.
No.
You didn't need the celebrity.
No.
Folk don't know that you've paid for 98.99% of everything that you've done with this gospel album at your own pocket.
Yes, sir.
People don't know that coming over to my world ain't gonna make you no bigger.
Mm-mm.
It ain't gonna get you no more followers.
Somebody told me I was gonna lose some followers from doing this.
Which you haven't.
I know I'm not.
You haven't. You haven't. So the question is, why?
The Spirit. One thing about the Spirit, Kirk, you can't deny it. When it's on you, when it's in you, you gotta release it. And it's been in me for a long time, and now is the right time to do it because I'm able to do it. I'm my own boss. I can make my own decisions. I can pay for the project. I don't have to ask nobody for nothing. If I was in a label deal, I would probably be up against some odds right now because they would tell me, oh, no, you should do another rap album.
Yes.
Won't nobody want to hear that? What are you doing, Snoop? You're gonna ruin your career.
It's very important, I think, for my community, which it should be your community.
Yes, sir.
And I think it's disappointing that we even have to even make the separation.
To separate, ain't no separate. Let's just say our communities.
Our community.
Because my grandmother is the reason why I did this record, and my grandmother would be—
Tell us about that.
My grandmother would be considered an elder, right? She passed away 3 years ago. She'd be 94 years old.
But 94?
Yes, Lord. So she would be an elder, right? So to me, this is the generation of the first generation of the people that started church that I grew up watching, you know, the great-grandmothers and the elders. So if she would approve this project, you should approve this project because this project is a spirit filler. It fills your spirit with love, joy, and happiness. Not about the messenger, but the message.
For even somebody as big as you to even realize that there's still parts of Snoop's heart that you want to even get better.
Yeah, because I look at what I do, Kirk. I look at how the kids love me, right? And I look at how the mothers love me and the grandmothers and the aunties. And I ain't never made no music for them. But they still love me.
So imagine
if I made some music for them, which is this.
So you mean to tell me that you are saying as a big celebrity that you're not perfect?
No, I'm an imperfect man.
You're telling me as a mega global star that you got some growing to do?
Man, I say it every day.
You mean to tell me that you as an icon in the game realize that you got some stuff about you that you want God to still clean up?
Man, God ain't done working on me. I'm letting him chisel on me right now. When was it that you decided that you wanted to become the voice of gospel music?
I don't think I ever decided anything like that, Calvin.
But you know that is what you are, right? Because you bridge the gap between old, new, hip, sanctified, secular. One thing about gospel music, it's never had somebody who could engulf both worlds. He was either the most gospelist person in the world, or either he was the most worldliest person in the gospel and really messed with him. But you like the equivalent of both. We love you. Like I told you, when I first met you, we was gangster rap. We love you.
Wow.
Gospel love you. So what was the thought process of you when you went into making records? Did you think that you would be that?
No. No.
So when it hit you, how did you react to that?
Good and bad. Good and bad. Good and bad. You know, it's I think, like, did you ever go through a little bit of fear when it hit for you?
Yeah.
There's a fear that comes, and I did not know how to deal with the fear.
The unexpectedness.
You're not used to people running up on you and like, hey, I want to, you know, because you don't know what that is. You don't, you know, if you stop it again, because I get my own gas. I take out my own trash.
Right.
I pick up my own kids from school. And so having people.
Your celebrity went from here to here, and then you doing regular things, and then people
regular
running
things,
up to you.
Yeah. And I still live in a regular city, like, you know, like you live in Cali,
mm-hmm.
where there's stars on every corner, but, you know, but in my city, was still a regular city. And I chose to live there because I wanted to be close to the heartbeat of people's pain.
Mm.
Realness, because I'm quite sure you feel this, that sometimes when people do music, they move out of the environments that the music birthed from them.
Right.
And you can't do really hood music if you're living up in Calabasas.
Nah, it ain't gonna work. Gospel music.
Same with gospel music. If you're not close to the barbershop.
You gotta have your hand on that heartbeat or you ain't gonna feel it, trust me.
You're not gonna feel it.
And that's probably why your music cut us so tough, because you was there. When you was making your music, like you said, you wasn't like here, you was in the hood making that thing.
I was visiting my sister in prison.
Mm.
I was visiting my sister who was incarcerated. She was dating some fool, you know.
What?
You know, with that backpack, you know what I'm saying, with that work.
What?
And she went down for over a decade, you know what I mean? So
you was writing her pain too?
Man, I was writing her pain. I was 13 and, heard my real mama tell the lady that adopted me that I didn't want him, I wanted an abortion, and you wouldn't let me. So, you know, man, I was living it. And I got a young lady pregnant when I was 16, 17, and the church kicked me out, man. And
what?
Yeah, yeah. So like, I was really, you know, yes, I was in the middle of that. I was in the middle of that. I dropped out of high school when she got pregnant. My mama put me out because my mom was an old church lady. She said, if you're not going to marry that girl, you can't live here. And I was sleeping in my car.
Sleeping in my car, too.
Yeah.
2 years.
Yeah. Mine was just about 13 months, but it's still a long time. That's a long time to be. And I had a trash bag, Snoop.
With your clothes in it?
In the back of the church. So I would go Sunday, wash up in the sink at the church, and put on my little Sunday clothes to church, and then go in the back and put back on whatever clothes I had in that trash bag. And silver and gold came in the middle of all that.
How was you choosing the singers, man? Because every singer that you ever put on your records had the greatest voices of all time. Like, what were you doing to find these people?
Is that for whatever reason, man, the songs that God was giving me was attracting those kind of singers.
Mm.
people that could really sing, really, they were enjoying the songs that I was writing. And so I was just blessed to be around great singers, from the family to God's property to, you know, to people like Isaac Creed, Nicky Ross, Anesha Figaro. I mean, just incredible people in the gospel game that wanted to be around me, and I wanted to be around them.
They magnated towards your spirit or your music.
And I was humbled by that. Man. I was really humble, and they enjoyed interpreting because I would tell them what to sing. You know, I would
sit down. You were
MD. Yes, sir. I would teach them the songs, teach them the parts, teach them the ideas, and the beauty of their voices made a good song a great song.
Because they took your idea and they made it what you knew it could be.
When it came out of their mouth, it was like I would go, wow. Yeah, and so that's kind of been the story of my life, man. Now, this is good. Ask me some more questions. This is good.
The record, I Smile.
I smile.
I love that record right there.
Thank you, man.
That is a beautiful, beautiful record right there. Whenever you down, that should be the record that you put on, just to smile, because ain't nothing wrong with smiling.
Yeah, man. Thank you.
What came over you when you made that?
Songwriting is a very weird thing because you can't time when it happens.
It ain't never right? The same way twice.
It ain't never the same. It could be at a stoplight one day, it's sitting on the toilet the next, right? You know what I'm saying? It can just be whatever it is.
Spontaneous.
Like, and I smile came one day, I was just pulling in the driveway. Today's a new day. I know, and that's all I had.
Just the beginning.
Yeah, today's a new day. And I had to bounce in my head. I went,
And there you go. Once you start mumbling.
And that was it.
I tell you one thing about the mumbles. I get Pharrell. Now, this Pharrell is an artist that I work with a lot.
He's dope.
When Pharrell work with me, he'll go in there and do a mumble track. Then he'd be like, all right, now write it.
Wow.
And I hear the mumbles.
Are you serious?
And I hear the words through the mumble.
Are you serious?
I swear to you, that's how me and him get out.
That is bananas.
He mumble me. He always mumble. He'd be like, man, I hear you. This is the way you should rap on a song. And they'd be like, all right, now put the words to it.
Oh, my goodness.
And I go in there and I listen to what he's saying. I'm like, dang, it sounds like he was saying.
Are you serious?
Yes.
That is crazy.
Yes. Is there an artist that you would love to work with that you've never worked with outside of gospel music?
Do you know who I would love to work with?
Who?
Sting.
Every Breath I Take? You know I got a line on him.
Do you?
Yes, sir. My artist I want to work with is Sade. I've been reaching out for her for a minute. Hopefully she'll watch this interview and give me that action I was asking for. Sade, quit playing. Sports.
Oh, God.
Why don't you like sports?
It ain't that I don't like sports, Snoop. And I don't appreciate you putting me out like that. It ain't that I don't like sports. As you can see...
You got all these Hall of Famer friends that's your best friends. And you know...
That's why they like me. No, real talk.
Because you don't judge them off of that.
And because I don't know what they do. From Emmett to Dion.
Michael Irvin.
Michael Irvin's the homie. Michael Irvin's the big homie.
Yeah.
Man, it's like I went to a game this past December in Dallas, and man, backstage, and they all was coming up to me, KD and
Steph Curry and all.
Steph and all of them, and they was knowing the music, and their mamas was going crazy, and I could not tell them anything that they had done that night.
Wow.
I was just like, how nice to meet you.
It is nothing about the game. Huh?
I couldn't have any dialogue about
the game. Nice rebound you got early.
Yes.
Good touchdown.
How did the basketball feel? You know, that's all I could say. That's all I know. But it's not because I don't like it.
Nah.
It's just my life was filled with music. And I ain't trying to be all deep. My whole life has been consumed with God, music, and pain. Mm.
But look how crazy it is how your God, music, and pain has transcended through all of these people.
I'm humbled. I am.
In different walks of life.
I'm mad grateful.
They mama love you.
I'm mad grateful.
They love you. Their kids love you. Grandma love you. Yeah. You hear what I'm saying?
And I'm grateful. I am. I'm not gonna lie to you. I'm mad grateful. And one thing that I always try to live by, Snoop, is that I know there's a scripture, one of my dope scriptures, and I don't know if you have one, and I would love to know what your favorite scripture is, but one of mine is, God opposes the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. And I love that because that reminds me that I should love what he loves and hate what he hates. Mm. He hates pride. And I wish that our political leaders could see that. And I wish that our social leaders could see that. And I wish that our church leaders and people in any level of leadership, if you are a prideful leader, God ain't rocking with you.
Nah. Leave that pride to the side.
He ain't rocking with you, my dude. Dude, you can pray and sing God Bless America and have the Bible in your room. If you a prideful dude, God ain't rocking with you. He ain't in the room, big homie. And that's 100, because God ain't gonna lie. He say he hate pride. So anybody, if your hustle is pride, if your sauce is pride, God ain't in the building, my G.
Mm-mm.
And I think that we need to realize that.
Hey, it's good that you spoke on that, because a lot of us need to let that be known, that pride sometimes get in the way of what we're trying to do.
Teach.
And if you don't have no pride, then you on God's side.
Teach.
So maybe you should lose that and try to be more of like God in the light.
Church.
In the walk, in the way of.
It's a cold world out there, dog. It's a cold world, and everybody just trying to make it. And I think the reason why it's so easy to hate on people is because it gives you a timeout from hating on yourself.
Mm. Wow, I never looked at it like that.
I never said it until now.
Mm.
That was good. That was
so
good.
So you hate yourself, so instead of you
working on yourself,
you're going to hate on somebody.
You take a timeout to hate on somebody else. And I think that this is a wonderful opportunity for people to see the man, not the icon, not the innovator, not the longevity of a career, but the human.
Yes, sir.
The flawed sinner saved by grace.
Yes, Lord.
And I want you to know that when I get to heaven, me and you and everybody gonna be on the same stage.
Do you know what song we gonna sing?
I hope it's a Kirk Franklin one.
Silver and Gold.
Come here, Ike. Come here. Yo, man, this big homie, Isaac Kareem.
Yeah, that's my man, right? That's my nephew. We family.
I'm gonna put that key, you can sing. Yeah. Huh?
Yep.
We dedicate this to Kevin Broadus.
Yes, Lord.
Come on. Sing, Kevin. Don't give me the world.
Don't give me the world.
With a shallow thrill.
With a shallow thrill.
Kevin, give me Jesus.
Would you give me Jesus?
My life he can hold.
My life he can hold.
Yeah, I'd rather have Jesus.
I'd rather have Jesus.
Sing, Kevin.
Than silver and gold.
Yeah.
Silver and gold. Silver. Silver and gold,
no fame,
no fame or fortune,
no riches,
no riches.
Come here, the homie. Come here, the homie. Come here, the homie.
I'd rather have Jesus.
This is your boy, ready?
Than silver and
try to hook, gold. Just try to hook one time. Silver and gold, buy these up. Silver and gold.
Silver and gold.
Say, homie. Silver and gold.
Silver and gold.
Yeah, brother, have Jesus.
I'd rather.
The silver?
Then silver and gold.
No fame or fortune?
No fame or fortune.
Yeah, no riches and toll.
No riches and toll.
I'd rather
have Jesus than silver.
I'd rather have Jesus
than silver and gold.
By yourself, Calvin, I'd rather have Jesus?
I'd rather have Jesus than silver and gold.
Hey!
I know
my king.